In this video, we will cover another Windows-based digital forensics tool, and it's called ProDiscover. And we're using the basic version, so it has limited functionality, but that's okay because we're just looking at the process and how, in general, the tools work. If you like the commercial version, you can go to their website and purchase that if you wish. But for our needs in this class, this should work fine. Note that the software is contained on your textbook CD. In fact, all the software is contained in your textbook CD. So why don't you get that installed, and then we can start looking at how ProDiscover works. What we're going to do is we're going to be creating an image of a thumb drive. And what I've got here, and actually I got two of them, one of which is in my computer right now, but it's a small thumb drive. This is the, I can see how to open this. This is a small 64 megabyte USB thumb drive, so you need something small. It doesn't really matter how large it is. It's the smaller the better, because we're just going to be looking at the process and how these tools work, so you don't need a 4 gigabyte or anything large like that, so try to get something small. So it doesn't take much time to do the imaging and verification. And so I have 128 megabyte in my computer right now, so we'll use that for this video. All right, let's take a look at ProDiscover. And this is the freeware version. This is the basic version, so it has limited functionality, so you get what you pay for. This is the initial screen. It wants us to create a project number and name. So we'll go ahead and we'll do that. You have the capability of not showing this dialog in the future, but before you do anything else, if you don't see this screen, it's still going to want to it will ask you to create a project, so let's go ahead and create a project now. Make this smaller. And you see that the screen is partitioned into two quadrants. In the left-hand quadrant, you have a tree-like structure in here, which allows you to view your port, which we shouldn't have yet. Yeah, we have nothing in the report outside of the name and the project number. It allows you to add media. You can either add an image file, or you can add a physical disk, or you can capture and add the images, which is something we'll review shortly. It provides you with two different views. A content view, which is the logical view, which is, I'll show you in a few moments. Doesn't work that well for the graphic files, at least for the graphic files I have on my Memrex thumb drive. It also provides for a cluster view, which is a physical view, which is what we saw previously when we were looking at FTK Imager. And actually, FTK Imager has both a content view and a cluster view. So this is the logical view, and this is the physical view. We can view our log file. We'll do that shortly once we capture and add an image. And we can do some basic searches on the content of the image. So let's first go ahead and let's capture and add an image. Select our source drive. Notice that it shows all our source drives, including the Memrex thumb drive. We can also capture physical memory, which might be useful, for example, if we know somebody is using encryption keys and they've typed their password into dialog box, and if that's not written out somewhere, it could still be available in RAM. Tells us a total sector to capture, destination. It wants the name of the file. We'll say just, for example, 2.dd. Now the ProDiscover format is a proprietary format, which would include the raw data as well as any metadata that you would type down in here. So you can include your technician name, the image number, and a description of the media. You can also compress it if you like. You can also include a password. If you do use a ProDiscover format, it's going to require that someone else, if you're going to be sending this to someone, that another examiner would have ProDiscover software, because I don't believe any of the better known digital forensic software tools support the ProDiscover format, so just realize that. However, the DD format is universally accepted. This tells us the total sectors to capture, and we can click OK. Let's go down and select H. Total sectors to capture 258,048, and that is correct, as we saw from our example with FDK Imager. We click OK. It says it's not going to write out any metadata, so we click OK, because we want to compare the MD5 hashes for the FDK Imager and the ProDiscover tools. So this will take a couple of minutes. Let me pause. Okay, and after a couple of minutes, we get this dialogue that indicates the image capture was complete. We need to please check the log file for any errors. Let's go down to View Logs. We can look at our log file for ProDiscover. There are no IL errors. So that's good. So now let's go back over to the content view and look at our images. We've only got a single image, so we can click on that. And this shows us our logical view. If we scroll over to the right, well, we have file name, file extension, the size, the DOS attributes, whether it's deleted or not, the date that the files were created. And notice here, 12/31/1969, 1900 hours. And I believe I discussed this in the previous Linux class, and this is just the I'm not sure why it's showing 1969. The Unix epoch, which is the date and time that is used to revise modified access and created times for Unix, is 1/1/1970, and this is showing 12/31/1969. So for some reason, when I created this disk, it's indicating that this is just a few hours before the Unix epoch. And I'll need to take a look at that and see why it showed that. It shows the parent folder. Notice up here, this is something that we'll talk about later, is the master file table standard information and master file table file name. This will only show up for NTFS files. And it shows us the checksum over here for the different files, and notice that those weren't calculated. And there's a reason that we would want to calculate the hashes of the files, and the reason is, so if we go up here and look at the tools, filter by hash set, we just select hash files. We're not going to do this right now, but let me explain that. We can use file hashes, cryptographic one-way hashes, MD5s, or the SHA hashes, for a couple of good reasons. One of which is to filter out the known good files. For example, when we install Windows, when we install Microsoft Office or any other well-known applications, they have a hash. And if we calculate those hashes and match them to a set of known good hashes, we know that those are the files that they say they are. And so what it allows us to do is to filter out the known good files. And so we can take 100,000 files and then narrow them down to maybe 10,000 files or 5,000 files whose hashes don't match any known good hash, because there's no reason to go in and look at a Microsoft DLL for Word if we know that file came from Microsoft, and we know that and hasn't been altered. And the other reason is we can use a hash set of known suspected files, for example, hashes of malware files that don't change. And so what we can do is we can narrow down our search and compare the hashes of these files with a set of known suspected files to identify any known bad files. And that could also go, for example, for known child pornography files. There are hash sets for child pornography files. And what this allows us to do is to identify those, because somebody may download those files and change the name. Well, you can't really go by the name, but we can identify the known bad files by the hash. So if we have a child pornography file that has a particular hash, we take the image of that media and we hash it, and we see that the ND5 sum is the same as the one in the hash set of known child pornography files. We know that that's that file, regardless of what the file name is. So notice one interesting difference down here. Let me double click on this. Here we go. Okay. So I said this was the logical view, which it is, as we see over here, even though the pcregger is the volume label, and we saw that in the FDK imager video. But this is not showing a logical view, this is showing a physical view. But if we double click on the file, as I just showed right here, we can see the logical view, but notice that it's opening up in the default application for this file here, and which obviously means that you have to have a default application associated with each particular type of file. Although if you look at the text file, this does show the text contents. If we go over to cluster view and select our image, what this is showing is a physical representation of the clusters. These are color-coded, and this is very difficult to work with, by the way, what I found. The red is whatever's selected. The sector number, this is the first sector, the second sector, and so on. So this 0 and 1 are the offsets from 0. And so if we have the first sector selected, we see that this is the volume boot record, or the master boot record. And then everything else in here that is in green is reserved space. So everything you see in here, if we scroll roll to the right, remember there was 4K that's reserved according to FDK Imager. Everything in blue is unallocated, that it is not used. And notice that this shows us about a third. If you look down here, cluster 757 of 64, 375, this does only show us not a third, but only a portion of our space. And so what we need to do is to use these keys down here, for which for some reason now are unavailable. Or we can actually jump to a particular cluster number. So I find this very difficult to use. In contrast, NCASE does the same thing. It will show you the similar graphical representation of everything, but you can actually scroll down to actually see the entire disk. So I find this somewhat unuseful. If we go to search, we can actually search for particular keywords, and we can do a content search or a cluster search. And so if we go to the content search, we can search for things that we know are in the file. Let's go back. Let's close this quickly. Let's go back over here and I'll show you what I mean. Let's go to dsc.ping. Notice this has some human readable text in here, as well as binary information. And so let's search for warning right here. So we can go back over here, do a case sensitive search for warning, and see how many files it shows up in. We just select the disk image, click OK, and we see that it showed up in a single file. And so what this allows us to do is to document what we found. So it's a warning. We go back up to report. and we can see the results of our simple examination here. It tells us about the, and this is interesting because some of this information is wrong, sectors per cluster. This should get this all from the master boot record, total sectors, hidden sectors, total capacity, and so on. Interesting. Evidence of interest. Notice that it tells us for the file we selected, the list of files, dsc.ping, it created the checksum of that file. It tells us the modified access and created date. Notice that the master file table information is unavailable because this is a FAT16 disk. It tells us the starting and ending cluster and investigator's comments. So one more thing that we have to do is to check by going to the folder where we created our file and check the MD5 sum of the disk. And I did that, and the MD5 sum of the DD that was created by ProDiscover is the same as that of created by FDK Imager, so we have some external information to verify that at least the two tools have created the same exact image. So it's good to know these tools. It's good to know the limitations and the strengths of the tools. And obviously this is a very basic version of a tool. Some of this information is obviously not correct. Example in here, the total capacity and so on, the starting and the ending sectors. So again, this is the basic version. This is an old version, so you kind of get what you pay for.